Hello, welcome back to Archiviews. So we are here in the episode 3. I hope you like the series till now. Today we are joined by architect Satish Vayuvegula. He has been working for a lot of years now. He's been my teacher in between as well. So there's a lot to discuss with sir. So now before we actually start discussing with sir, let me tell you a little bit about him.
Architect Satish Vayuvegula is a LEED accredited professional and a strategic thought leader with 17 years of experience. After completing his post-graduation degree from Louisiana State University in the US, he joined the rebuilding efforts for the city of New Orleans post-Hurricane Katrina. After a brief tenure, he relocated to Dallas, where he worked in the capacity of a designer on projects of different nature in various parts of the world, ranging from 6 lakh square feet to 30 lakh square feet. Relocating to India in 2009, he led the design efforts towards the renovation of Eden Garden Cricket Stadium in Kolkata. He then worked as a professor in Manipal University, Jaipur, and today, he is the studio head for DesignQube Jaipur. Having so much of work experience, talking to him is always enriching.
Alright, so let's dive into the interview. So sir, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, about where you studied architecture and then your masters and everything beyond?
Well, okay, let me first start with who I am. Let me put it this way. I am a South Indian by region, a North Indian by, let's say, education, and a global by work.
Okay.
Right? So I think that probably helps to understand what I'm coming from. But yeah, to directly answer your question, I did my bachelor's in architecture from Indore. There was a school called Institute of Environmental Planning and Technology. I believe it's closed now. I'm not very sure. And then I worked in Indore for about 3 years, upon which I thought I need to learn more in architecture, and that's why I decided to pursue a master's from US.
Okay.
Yeah. So I went to Louisiana. It's called Louisiana School of Louisiana State University. I did a 3-year master's in architectural design. This was year 2006. That's when I graduated.
So then you started, after you graduated, you worked for a while in US.
Yeah, that's right.
And then you came back to India and started working in India as well.
Mm-hmm. So I worked in US for almost 3 years in the cities. So first was, it was the city of New Orleans, which right after the Hurricane Katrina, there was a tremendous need for architects. And eventually I shifted my base to Dallas, where I joined a company called Lagwar Dalu, which is primarily a design boutique firm. And I think 2009 is where I got back to India for good.
Okay, so now we're going to start with our segment 1, which is the PDF, or the practice, the design and the field. So you have had a lot of work experience across various firms and you have even worked as a project manager.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could tell us how the work of a project manager differs from that of an architect in a big firm.
Sure, it's not about a big firm. First of all, a project manager and architect, it's about a big project, how you handle it. So even a smaller firm, but if you have a substantially big project, you do need a project manager. See, typically what happens is there's a thin line. When we say architect, okay, it's good enough if you're doing a residence, you have done designs, you have done drawings, maybe you go to the site once a while, you sort of do the supervision and all. But when it comes to bigger projects, there are a lot more disciplines involved in it. And so you do need a guy who would make a schedule, a time schedule, a budget schedule, track the different disciplines involved, track the different consultants involved, and that's where I think a project manager comes in. So he's primarily one guy, I think, in a bigger project room, you can say even the architect reports to him.
Yeah.
So he is like the sole taker of the project. So unless and until you have a really good guy who has, but the basic qualification of the project manager should be not just he's like an MBA who knows how to do that. I think he should be an architect too, who understands the design. Because unless you know the design, you can't really predict the delivery of it.
yeah, he needs to bridge better the gap between
exactly. So I think if you look at the market, there is a tremendous opportunity for people who are probably in architecture and an MBA. I mean, there's a very high need. There are very few people in probably in the country who you can really say are a true blue project managers.
Okay. If you talk about pay scales, are project managers paid more or less than architects? And what is the best route to becoming a project manager after you've done your graduation?
Typically, project managers are paid more than the architect because you're doing more work, for sure. As an architect, your work mostly concentrates on the drafting board. But as a project manager, the site is your drafting board. So the scale is very different. So that's why I think the payment is more, and they play a really big role in the execution part of it. Now, coming to what was your second question about?
What is the best route to take best after route. Graduation?
There are a couple of ways. I think there are a bunch of courses in India as well as abroad. Not necessarily they are called project management. You can do what is called a construction management. So for example, I think in Pune, in ICMA, you can do a construction management course. One of the best courses I have seen in US is in, there's a place called TAM, Texas A&M University in College Station campus. So they have a very good course in a certification in project management.
Okay.
So there are a bunch of them. I think even in India there are. Or else experience, like I personally haven't done any course in project management. But maybe I was lucky that the people or the mentors whom I work with, and when I asked them, okay, you know, guys, can you tell me how to, you know, it's like, say, for example, you are given awarded a project, how will you decide what is the apt fee for that?
Yeah, that is a big.
Yeah, so how do you code that? You can't just say, oh, I'm going to charge you, like $1 million or $500,000 for this. Like, how do you come to that number? So that is where I think you need that skill set. You will calculate, you know the design, you calculate the delivery, you calculate the man hours involved, you tie them to the salaries.
So it's a field where you get better the more you work in it.
Exactly. So that's how I learned, at least, because when I started working with my peers, and then I kept asking, okay, how do I do this? How do I do that? And I think I probably had more interest towards it. So I went ahead and I started, you know, understanding the whole process of how do you make schedules, how you budget certain things, what if you are not on track, how to get back on track, you know, things like that. But definitely you need a formal education, that could always help.
Now we kind of like to talk about digital architecture on this show. So mm-hmm. I've been talking to other architects also about achieving architecture through digital manipulation. So what is your take on it?
See, it's a good thing. I think it has made a little bit more easier for us to visualize what there is in the mind. For example, you know, if you go back, it's not like back in the day people never made anything that was not organic or that was not very fluidic. And I look at the works of Gaudi.
Yeah.
I don't think he had any software to do what he did. So he was still able to do it. Except it took more time. Probably there were a lot more trial and errors. But with the aid of, so let me put it this way, when we call it digital architecture, it's not that the computers are doing anything. The designing is still yours. It is just a tool for you to probably visualize it more faster and more accurate.
Yeah.
You know, had there been no software, you know, probably Gary could have just made paper architecture. That wouldn't have been able to build it. So that's what it's just an aid. So it's a good thing. I mean, because we're able to, and it's not just what people do is generally a common misconception is when you say someone digital architecture, all they think is something which is organic, which is fluidic. In fact, even boxes can be digital architecture and people don't go with that. The moment you say someone and parametrics, they all trend to make it very, very fluidic.
Yeah.
It's not the case. So yes, I think that's the current thing. And in fact, one of the saddest thing I found is, if you go abroad, there are schools which sort of specialize in taking digital as a means of architecture. So that I'm deliberately not saying digital architecture. I'm saying taking being digital as a means of architecture. Whereas in our country, I think we still are, at least in the schools, we are a little behind. I think there are schools that should take up that. And because we still, I haven't come in a lot of schools where they actively encourage students to
there
go.
Is, one in Pune that I heard of, and all I know of it is it's an all girls college.
Oh.
Where they've taken up digital architecture to another level. They have robotic arms, they have everything in that college only.
That's nice. No, because there are really good places around the globe. Like if you go to, if you talk about SciArc, if you talk about the one in Frankfurt, I forgot, and there is this ICAP in Barcelona. These are like, maybe they are like way too ahead. Of course, I mean, we are still way behind that. But still, we should encourage students to, like, you know, it's like, I find it mundane in schools to teach AutoCAD. I think it's almost extinct. So let's teach Revit, let's talk about BIM, like, but we still talk about architecture, so, I mean, the CAD part, but that's how it is, so.
Yeah, what I also personally feel, see, even though we need to learn all those old methods as well, and sketching is something you rely on all throughout architecture, and that is not something you give up. You just need to keep practicing, so first semester they teach you sketching, after that, I think they're not supposed to. Now, you will do sketching on your own, and explore more options.
True, because there is no end to it.
Yeah, and even as you said about parametric architecture, so in India when people talk about parametric architecture, they still talk, they talk about very fluidic things, they talk about motion, kinetic sculptures. What we also somewhat fail to understand is the word itself, parametric, means it's based on certain parameters. So it does not need to be fluidic, it does not need to be kinetic. We could just, for example, all we can do is if we are designing a chhajja of sorts for a window and it is based on a sun's the sun's angle of incidence, so that is a parameter that we've put into it.
Sure.
So now when we're designing it for the whole housing and it comes up and down and up and down at different angles, that in a very simplistic term is parametric architecture. So people always sort of tend to move towards fluidic things, kinetic things, but they somewhat forget. Like,
yeah, I mean, even if you look at, like, go back in the day, let's talk about the Vitruvian Man, let's talk about the golden ratio. What is it? It's still parametric.
Yeah, it's all based on,
based on proportions, and then you have these proportions. So that meant, and probably you take the same algorithm and put it in a grasshopper, and you get the same result.
And even those like Greek orders, columns, and everything.
Yeah, everything was parametric. Yeah. All you have to do is take that equation. And take those parameters, put it in a grasshopper thing, and then you get the result.
Yeah.
So it was existent all the way. It was existent all the way. Yet we just never saw it that way. We just only saw it like, okay, it only like Zaha and probably Frank Gehry does parametric elements. And that's not true.
Okay, so that was the end of our first segment. Now we jump on to segment two. So in segment two, we will discuss a project that sir has designed, and we'll ask sir certain questions about that project so that we can learn how to design better in the field. So before we actually go on to it, let us now look at the project.
Located in Vaishali, this house designed for a family has a very interesting story attached to it. Originally intended to be designed as a modern home with a warm and cozy feel to it, the clients initially wanted mellow and soothing interiors. Later, the client decided they were not happy with the original design. After trying to figure out what the clients actually like, a new design was evolved with bolder and brighter colors, making the space so much more energetic. The house, now completed, gives you a feeling of an amazing Fab India store. Why do I use this reference? Well, let's find out from sir himself.
So sir, could you tell us a little bit about the site and the brief that you got for the project?
Sure. Well, there were a couple of projects. It's actually hard to choose which one to talk about. So we'll probably talk about something we recently finished in Jaipur. It's an interior job. Any other residence, really nothing special about it. But there was a very interesting story behind it, and that's why I chose to talk about this. So we have this project in an apartment complex called Rangoli Gardens, which is pretty close to in Vaishali, regular 3 BHK, very simple apartment. The owner is a doctor by profession who lives in Mumbai, and they're planning to shift to Jaipur. So when we first got the brief, we were asked to design contemporary residences. And usually what we do, you know, as part of DesignQube where I work with, we send up a questionnaire to the clients in terms of what their requirement was. And the questionnaire is pretty different in terms of not just requirements. We ask them, who is the user? What is your favorite book? What is your favorite character? What is your favorite movie? So that we get a vibe about, you know, his lifestyle, his likings and all. So we got all of this. We went ahead. We took like 3 weeks. We designed. We gave the drawings. Everything was fine except one day the client called me up and said his daughter-in-law is an architect.
Yeah.
And they think it's very beige hospitality like interiors. And so we were like, well, but that's what you wanted. You wanted your house to be simple, minimalistic and not. And so we kept debating over. So again, you know, but for us to make any change, there has to be direction. Like if you are my client and I give you something, you say, I don't like it. I'm going to end up scratching my head, like, which part doesn't he like it? How do I improve it? You can't just say, so that's not a very constructive feedback.
You have like some input.
Yeah, you need to have an exact input. So we were unable to find one. I think there were really no words about it. Okay, they just said, this, we'll find it a little mundane. This is more beige. This. And so we kept talking. We called their daughter-in-law. And then we said, okay, now let's forget about architecture. Let's talk about the places you have gone. Let's talk about the places you have gone and what do you like in there. Maybe it could be a movie theater, it could be a mall, it could be a shopping center, it could be a piece of cloth, the colors. And so I think out of this discussion, the theme that emerged was, can we make our house look like a Fab India?
Okay.
And that was the word. So now we'll go back to books. What is Fab India about? It is a very good combination of sort of Indian ethnic with a lot of earthen pastels,
yeah,
and a contemporary fusion. You know, it has a mix of everything,
yeah,
but very subtly done. So you still feel you are an Indian when you walk in the Fab India, but then you also cater to the Western mind. That's what they also probably target their clients to.
Yeah.
So that was a good start for us to begin with, and then we started working on it. So we revamped the whole thing. We introduced a lot of bold colors, like, you know, a navy blue, a mustard, orange.
Yeah.
Changed the furniture types. We made it a little bit more like a baluster themes and all that. And on top of it, I think the biggest challenge was they wanted us to do a Murphy bed.
Okay.
So what is a Murphy bed is it's like, it's not very common in India. You can basically roll over your bed, like just collapse it on the wall.
Okay.
Now what happens when it is collapsed? You see the back of it, right? You see all the mechanism, but that doesn't look good. So we had a lot of challenges. We did a lot of trial and error at site, because every time you have to close it, we really don't want them to see the hardware.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have to design like a supporting wall panels, and you can see in the images that we placed this the kundis, we placed a lot of moldings so that it looks like a wall panel when it is closed.
Okay.
And of course the entire team went to that Fab India. In fact, even the artifact we used in the project, like right from paintings to the artifacts, everything changed. So it is not like, because there is a common tendency, what happens is even in school when we teach, we tell students this doesn't quite work, so they just change that part. But what is that? Is that particular change affects the whole lot.
Yeah.
But we don't really talk about it, because we want to talk about, okay, this is what was supposed to be changed, and
yeah,
we changed it. Now here that didn't happen because we had to change that color scheme. Everything got changed. The way the furnitures were designed, the way the artifacts were, the lights, instead of white, we went for yellow lights.
Yeah.
So everything had a difference.
Everything has a conversation.
Yeah. Because it's a theme. You can't just say, I'll just change the colors and it will work out.
Yeah.
So I think that what made the project very much interesting. And of course, as any other good client, they want those changes to be done in the same budget what they told us before.
Yeah.
So it was a good challenge. I think it was a good exercise. We did some mistakes, but we learned from it. And in that, it turned out to be a really good project. Something like we showcased on our website. And then you can see too, I mean, it turned out really nice.
Yeah,
we are yet to do a good photo shoot of it though, because the clients moved out once they were done. And then we got busy when they came back.
Okay.
But it turned up, it's very small. It's probably like 1200 square feet carpet area. Really not big. But I think the scale helped us to narrow down to detail everything in that. So everything right from the light fixture to the wall, color, texture, paintings, artifacts, plans, everything had a new makeover based on the theme.
Yeah, and it is sort of like quite different from what their initial.
So we have both renderings. Like usually what we do is we give clients a 3D photorealistic renderings, and you can see what was done before, which got approved, and then changed, and what was the changes after. Okay. So you can compare like how, you know, the design elements change just because they wanted a fab idea.
So this sort of, you've answered my next question also, which was what did the client have in mind. And so initially you just gave you like what we want is a minimalistic, modernistic house, right. And you designed in that way, and then he came up with like...
Right. Change. So what we generally do is when we send the questionnaire, there is a link there for them to upload their images they like. It doesn't have to be a residence, it could be anything. But that tells us a story, like, you know, which direction, because it's very difficult to read someone's mind.
Yeah.
And the best way to understand a client is through graphically. Like you can always talk about concept, and but for him, it has to be a graphical thing. Like if whatever I want to show him, it has to be very much graphical. I can't just rely on words, we'll do this. And there is no point, like you can't really don't want to build castles in here and say, this is this, because in the end, when they see the picture, and if it's not what they were expecting, then, you know, there is a waste of time and effort for both.
Yeah, this takes me back to the urban studio that you taught us, wherein, so we did the city of Pushkar, covered, like we were studying Pushkar for an urban design project, and the first assignment sir gave us was go to the city and take photographs of the city.
Right.
And it doesn't have to be anything architectural, just take photographs, bring back 10 photographs that you think define Pushkar.
And yeah, that defines the character of the city.
Yeah, that was a really interesting exercise.
Of course. I mean, it tells us about what, like, it should be so nice, like when you see those pictures, it talks to you about what that place is all about.
Yeah.
That should convey. And the photographs should be so self-explanatory, they'll convey the different aspects of Pushkar.
Yeah, and this is nice, bring me into the field as well.
Yeah.
And understanding the client now, because you're not the same exercise, not the city, now you're trying to understand the client, the picture that best.
Yeah, because you know, in business, there is nothing better than a satisfied client.
Yeah.
Both professionally, monetary, however you put it.
So, working with a budget with the client, so the client would have quoted his initial budget, and so now when you change the design as well, so how did the design process change when you have a budget that comes into the picture? So in school you're not really, you do anything you want, and you can do something modern, you can do something as fluidic, which would increase the budget as well, because in school you're just free. When you come into the field, you have a certain budget as well.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to learn to design within that budget. Mm-hmm. So when the client quoted his budget, how did that change your designing process?
Honestly, it didn't much. There is this, again, I would say a misconception among different people that you can't give a good design in a small budget or in a specified budget. I never felt that. I think design can be given to even a smaller one. What you have to really understand is the specifications. So the same thing can be achieved, like, you know, you see this chair, I mean, this is solid wood. Maybe you could have done generally this wood part and inside ply, so it could be at a lesser price.
Yeah.
So you just change, so the look and feel still remains the same if you talk about the design. So if you're really talking about only the design idea, maybe it is restricted to the budget, let's say only 10%, maybe 20%. Rest is all specifications, and you got to be smart. That's where I think you come in as a designer, is you got to know what materials are you want to choose.
Yeah.
And so within that you can always create a good design. It's not like every time the flooring has to be marble. You know, you can put tiles and it will be still splendid. So I personally don't believe that a budget has a very much influence on it. It does definitely to a certain extent. But you got to be really creative to come up with a really good design within even a small budget. Of course, there are places when you there is a restriction because the budget is way too small even for the specification. Like, you really don't want to compromise a lot also on your specification. You want to build a good project.
Yeah.
A good project with a good design. And it is easily achieved in any budget, I think.
Okay. So, but you just have to know your materials.
Yeah, that is something you have to know. Then you have to be really thorough. What is there in the market? What it's going to cost you upfront? You have to know it. So when we design something, that's why when we send our questionnaire to the client, we actually don't ask them for a specific budget. We ask them to give a range.
Okay.
And the objective is what we do is when we show them 3Ds, we make it so photorealistic. We take pride that it will be exactly like that. We don't make any changes in the 3D. So if you see a certain, even a switch in 3D, it's going to be the same in reality. But then when we make that, we make sure like whatever we choose is first available, and secondly, it's in the budget that the client is asking for.
Yeah. This also brings me back to one thing you told me once during my internship was, in an internship, because in college, we are already taught to design a lot. So when you're working under somebody, the best thing to do under an internship is learn things that you already do not know.
Yeah, designing you all know. I mean, come on, we can't teach you design.
So taking the best out of the experience, when you were at the internship, learning about materials, learning, sitting in the meetings, like go to your boss and tell.
Yeah, just sit, observe, and see how we talk, see what is happening, you know. And then college, it's all about design. You probably never even think while designing how you're going to make it.
But
when you're doing work, when as an intern, I think it should be the other way. Don't even worry about design. Think about how he's going to make it.
Yeah.
So when you come back, then you have both knowledge of both sides. Like you have already studied design 5 years. How much more time you want to spend in design?
This is what my thesis guide also. We used to have a lot of clashes on this only because I used to make, this was before my internship. So I used to make a lot of things that I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this. He's like, okay, you want to do this. You would also tell me how would this be done. So he would not let me put as many things in my project without knowing how it is done.
Which is a good thing.
Yeah.
Which is a really good thing. You know, you should know, like, you know, your extents, where to how far you want to reach.
Yeah. Okay. So talking about concepts, we are always taught to have concepts in design.
Mm-hmm.
So, as you told us about the Fab India concept that you came up with. So, how important when it comes to designing in the field, how important are concepts and how are those, because in architecture school, the concepts are up to us. So how in the field, how much are the concepts up to you and how much do they depend on what the client actually wants?
Well, this is very interesting because just last week I had a long talk in my office to my staff about why are we not doing any concept drawings. You know, it's like, why is this thing that conceptual sheets are only done in school and not in practice? We very much do concept sheets. I think they are probably more important than what you had in school. Because I think one is we underestimate the clients that they don't know design. They actually know design. They all know what they want. It's just that they just don't know probably how to put it together.
Yeah.
So having a good concept, a good theme really helps you to justify what you're trying to do. All being said, so whatever we have done so far in this office design queue for the past year and a half, we always had a concept drawing. And not like a concept sheet like how you do in school, that my concept is a leaf, my concept is an alphabet. So form is not a concept, you have to understand this. But it's a design idea.
Yeah.
Like where do you want to go? So for example, we recently worked for a showroom for a jewelry in our brand. And then the concept was we took their values and made it a concept. So it should be more on a sort of like a theme and a design idea, and then you can't nail down the concept. What we do in school is you will take a certain form and you will nail your everything in that.
Yeah.
Okay, my concept is a giant, I don't know, robot. So your building will look like a giant robot.
Yeah.
So you practically nail it there. You don't do that. The concept evolves over time. Concept means it's a start. It is never an end. But I still remember back in the school, the concept drawings were made at the last because you have to give it to the
yeah,
last.
Yeah.
Right? But it is something that should be evolved. It is not something that should end. But we do the other way. We always end it in school.
Yeah.
So I think that's a big difference. And that's why I think even when I was teaching, I used to put more emphasis on the process, not on the product. The final product is okay. You know, you might get it, might get it. That's a different story. But school is all about process, because if your process is clear, you will reach.
Yeah.
The process is very important. So I think concept is yes, a very must in all projects. Let it be school, let it be practice, no matter how many years you have in practice, I still feel concept is very important.
All right. So that was the end of segment two. So we have had an amazing conversation with sir about projects, about the field. Now we'll actually move on to segment three, which is all about education. So now we're going to ask the questions that are relevant to people who are still studying and what they can do for a better future. So before we start with anything else, this is something I've already asked other architects, and I would continue to ask this as well. Is something that everybody's asked, how did you end up studying architecture?
Well, okay, I think I'll be honest on this. There was no intentions of doing architecture. I think back when I passed out 12th, I was good in sketching, but not like sketching buildings. I was probably like, I think I was making a lot of cartoons probably.
Yeah.
And so people told me, you know, you draw good, so why don't you try architecture? I did get, but was just for the sake of it. In fact, the results were pretty late for architecture, so I ended up taking a BSc Computer Science at a very good school, a very good college in Indore. And so everything was going well. I think my classes started in August. In October, I received the first architectural call about the counseling, but I was out in Jabalpur, like I was representing Indore on basketball. Okay. So I was not in the town, so I missed my counseling. So I was like, fine, I'm anyways doing computer science, you know, big deal. But then the second call came for Indore, and so then I thought, you know, this looks more like a little non-study field. It's more like drawing. Anyways, I like drawing, let me take it. So I think that's how I ended up taking architecture. I was the first student of the first batch. So that really helped. And then, but eventually I think first year was fun, second year was more fun. But from third year onwards, there was some interest in it. There was like, this is...
Third year onwards, things started.
Yeah, the feeling was, this is really nice, and there's something new. And the best part was, I think I enjoyed it, every day is a new day.
Yeah.
Unlike others where you go and probably learn the same thing. You know, this is like a math where 1 + 1 could be anything.
Yeah.
Every day it changes. So that, I think, was interesting. And by the time thesis came, of course, it was like, you know, that was the thing, and we didn't have any computers or like, I think access to the resources were very limited.
Yeah.
So you had to travel a lot. Now what you do is you can do it at your desk.
Yeah.
But we had to travel a lot.
Pinterest.
Yeah. So then we went, I think I did a nice architectural tour in 2000, right before thesis. I did from Indore, Bhopal, Delhi, Ahmedabad, Jaipur and back. And went across a lot of cultural centers and explored the works of like Charles Correia, Doshi.
Yeah.
A lot of these people came back, then worked on the thesis. So yeah, that I think made an interest. And then, you know, once you graduate, like any other guy, I was like, oh, now I know architecture.
Yeah.
Let me start my own firm. So I was working part-time, but I started my own. So you had this like architectural, you know, they call it architect's ego, like I'm the best designer.
Yeah, and everything.
I think after 3 years, I realized like, probably I don't even know like 5% what is architecture is. So I decided to give it another shot. Then went for a design, a 3-year design course in US. And that's how masters happened. But that really helped because the program what I did in masters was very, very deeply process oriented. So back in the day when I was doing my bachelor's, and you know, my faculty would say, so after the end of the project, like how many sheets have you got?
Yeah.
I'll be like, 4, and he'll be like, oh, your colleague made like 20. I was like, I don't know what he made, I can only do 4. I have no clue how he managed to make 20. But then, so when I did masters, I still had the same answer. I did 4, but those 4 were process.
Yeah.
And I think that really helped me. So I ended up getting a faculty design award there in US on that class. And my project was very much appreciated. So, but it helps, you know, when you learn that, what you wanted to do, and now you're doing it in the right way, it helps a lot. And then I think it has never been looking back from there. Like you kept working. I worked in New Orleans, then I worked in Dallas. By working in Dallas, I ended up working in quite different countries.
Yeah.
From there back to India, then again, the first project in India was a stadium, the very first time. So I think it kept adding. There were different projects that came my way, and I took all of them. So that helped.
And also, in between, you talked about traveling as well. So even though we have a lot access to a lot of things today and we can view the world from the internet, but I think traveling does give you a different perspective of it. And traveling, it does not need to be to faraway places as well. You can travel as nearby as you want, and not just going to the touristy places, but actually going into the busy streets, the old houses. So seeing how people react to their built environment, I think that helps a lot.
It's an experience, yeah. That you can't really get on movies.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still like, you know, Kindle can never replace a book.
Exactly.
No matter how many books you have,
yeah,
a book is a book.
Feel of a book in your hands, exactly. The smell, everything.
Everything makes a difference.
Yeah. Okay, so as you said, getting an education from abroad really helped you, and in a way that it taught you the value of process in designing.
Mm-hmm.
So, but would you recommend getting a master's from abroad to everybody who does architecture?
Not
who should actually pursue it?
I think one is you should be clear what you want to do. Do you really want to do a master's because your family wants you to do, or because your friends are doing it? So what exactly you want to do in life? Like even in architecture master's, like for example, I choose only design. There are a lot of, I could have gone in sustainability. Again, in sustainability, there are daylighting. You can just break it down to a lot.
Yeah.
So one should be very clear, do you really want to pursue it? For what? Then there are a lot of guys who probably think they can be much better in academics and not in practice. Yes, go for a master's, go for a PhD.
Yeah.
So I had this dilemma while I was doing my master's and I had a long chat with my brother about it. He said, you're going to invest 3 years in education. And you are saying you want to come back to India and start your own practice. So why not start now? You can use those 3 years to establish yourself.
Yeah.
Which made a lot of sense to me. Like, why go there, study for 3 years and immediately come back and start my practice rather than start my own here?
Yeah.
Definitely, when I go out in the field, you know, I'm going to learn by my mistakes. It's not like I'll come back from US as a perfect guy.
Yeah.
I definitely still make mistakes, which I'm going to do here anyways. And there is always a learning. That's why we call it practice of architecture, because it's still practice, it keeps evolving.
Yeah.
We never say it's complete. So I had this dilemma whether I should do or not do. But I went ahead because for me, I think I really wanted to go back and redo my education again. To learn the whole thing, the process, the everything, like right from what is a concept, what is a schematic, everything. I want to just go through it again. And then I worked for a few years, I came back, and then I started working here. So to answer your question, I think if you feel it should be a personal thing, you definitely want to specialize in something, go ahead and do it. Or you just want to be a regular general architect, like you know how we have a general physician in medicine.
Yeah.
Could be that, or you could be orthopedic, or
you could take up a specialty.
Yeah, anyone, you know, oncologist or anything. So that personal choice, that depends on you. Now coming to when people said about why not in India, why in US? I think I just went to US, there is no reason for that.
No.
Or probably I couldn't get a regular architectural design master's in India.
Okay.
Because what we have right now in India is we have a specialized degree. We have a planning, urban design, whatever. But you just don't like, what I wanted is to carry my bachelor's in architecture into my master's in architecture. And I couldn't find any program in India for that.
Okay.
And that was the reason I chose abroad. Had it been a regular program, because I still had back then thoughts about joining a construction management program. But that was the sole reason I decided to go abroad.
Okay.
Or let's say, for example, if some of you guys or even you are interested in digital architecture, then I think in India probably there is one only course I know in Anna University from SAP that offers a master's in digital architecture. I don't know of any else. So either that's the one, or then you choose abroad. And abroad doesn't necessarily mean US. I mean, it's the whole world right now.
Okay, any project which you find fascinating, any project that you got to learn a lot from?
Like my own project?
It could be your own project or a project that you love in design school.
Yeah, no, there is one project I learned a lot, my very first project in India, which I was telling you. So it's a very interesting story about it. When I was in US, so my colleague was there who used to work with me in the same firm. And I think he moved to India. He was an American, he moved to India, he started working here.
Okay.
And then I think this is probably the summer of 2000, 2009 or end of 2008, and I asked him, I'm also planning to move, and since you are in India, would you recommend a firm? He said, why don't you come to the place I'm working in? So I applied, and eventually I joined this office sometime in, I think, May or July. So my very first day, I walk in the office and the receptionist told me that I have to go and sit in the conference room. That felt a little weird, but I thought maybe they just want to meet me and say hello. Yeah. So I walked in a room, there were like a bunch of guys. So there was my colleague also and other guys. And the moment I walked in, they told me, meet Satish, he is the designer of the stadium. And so I had like, okay, like who, what? I had no clue what was happening, but I kept quite aside there. And then I came to know that the firm actually won the competition for designing the Eden Garden Stadium in Calcutta.
Yeah.
And it was their Dubai office, but they decided not to pursue it because of the fees. And the Indian office decided to take the project because we are in India, of course, and the stadium is here. So I ended up becoming the designer. And so I kept quiet through the whole meeting. And then they came to me and they said, so you need to work on a stadium. I said, I haven't designed a stadium before. They said, none of us have either. So I was like, so what do we want to do? And they said, well, you tell us, do you want to take it or not? And I was like, okay, I'll do it, but I need certain things. I need to visit 3 stadiums and I need a book.
Yeah.
They gave me everything.
Okay.
So it was very interesting. And so when we walked out, they said, when are you going to work? And I was like, let me find a place first to sit. So we started from there, and I think I designed a whole stadium. I really designed it. And then this visit happened because it took some time. Yeah. Because they were already working on it. So I had a lot of initial data with me. And so we designed, and so there was this guy who used to work in Revit. He worked, and two of us worked together. We ended up working like late nights pretty much every day. So we took the design and I went on a case study. And I came back, I told my colleague, let's trash all of this. I think we were doing really bad stuff.
We started all over.
Yeah, we'll start all over. And so there's subtle things, you know. For example, I still remember, if you read the books, you know, there is a side screen in cricket, which is behind the bowler and the batsman, that black screen, what you see. So there is a height standard as per ICC that you can follow.
Yeah.
But when I went to the stadium in Nagpur, they said they have changed the height, and I was like, why? They said, well, you know, Tendulkar is a short fellow. So for him, the vision of sight is little more taller, because when you are short, you actually end up seeing far more height. Like when you see the skate, the angle becomes more. And so whatever the standard height is, he felt uncomfortable, and we changed the height, we increased the height to 4 more feet. And I was like, so what about the books? And they said, well, he's Tendulkar. It's like, that makes sense.
Yeah.
If Tendulkar said we need to increase the height, it has to be increased. Like the books will change. So those are the things you actually learn inside. And in fact, I ended up giving an interview to a briefing in London. And so we went to Eden. It was pretty late. I think the flight was pretty late. And I believe we reached the stadium at around 10:30 at night.
Okay.
And I decided to just walk in the center where the pitch is. So they had the floodlights on. And you could just feel like it was so calm, and then you just like, I closed my eyes and felt, imagine that time the capacity of the Eden was about 1 lakh. So imagine you are a batsman and all those lakh people looking at you, expecting from you, like screaming, shouting. How would you, like, what kind of pressure you have? And so how can you do that? Like architecturally, how can you do that? I mean, I still don't have the answer. But that really taught us me a lot while designing, you know. So it is not just about the form, the space, it is more about the experience you get from that space. So that was a very interesting project, because I did undid. Then the whole, if you have seen the two blocks which are like a crisscross of columns, so I think on a flight that design came to me, and I was sitting with a structural guy. We sketched it on a tissue paper, and the only thing I told him is, I like it, but can you justify it and make it a structural element rather than just being a false element? And he said, yeah, go ahead, I'll do it.
Okay.
So it worked out. So everything tied up, and you started learning, okay, this is the way. So then that helped me understand how the forces travel.
Yeah.
Because he taught me that. And this was all on a flight, on a 2-hour flight this happened.
Yeah. So yeah, from there he could help you in...
Yeah, so when he told me the forces, it really helped me to get the exact inclination of the column.
Yeah.
So I think that was a very good exercise too.
That is a very interesting story.
And that was my very first project in India. And then it kept on. I worked on a medical college that happened by accident. I ended up becoming a project manager, the very first project for a large pharmaceutical company, because no one wanted to take it the job and I had no clue about the job, said I'll do it. So then everybody told, this is the worst project, this is in the office for the last 5 years. I said, you should have told me before, like, you know, I just took it now. So I think it all worked out eventually. It was very fun.
So I think something
you got to just grab the opportunities and believe. You know, they say the help is always there, but if you need,
you need it,
it comes your way.
Yeah. And don't, what I think we can take away is don't afraid to be the first.
Never be. There is always there. Like, at least make an attempt. Yeah. What will you do? You will maximum commit a mistake, but then learn from your mistake.
Yeah. Okay. So any advice for our student viewers who are still in school?
You know, this is a difficult part because I got to walk the talk. Because now I have taught you guys, and if I say something else, you'll be like, me, you know, this is not what you taught us before. That's a tricky part. I think as a student, there is a, I mean, people, students say, oh, we are working hard. But I feel the more effort you put on the earlier years of your career, and then when I say career, the career starts when you enroll into the architectural program. The more the efforts you put from day one, the easier the life becomes at the end.
Yeah.
So, but if you keep thinking, no, I'm just a student, you know, but when I start working, I do this, I learn this, it becomes more difficult. So I think my only advice would be, you know, put as much as effort possible right from day one. Don't think, I mean, this is the school is like an investment to your architectural you know, career. So if you take it wisely, you will definitely reap the benefits later on. But if you are more into, like, because in school you will find probably the other discipline guys, like your colleagues, probably they might be enjoying a Friday night party and you might be sitting in the studio and you'll be like, ah, no, I'm gonna go there. Yeah, it's good to go, you know, you should take a break. But again, I think that's where the hard work is also needed.
Yeah.
So that's my only advice, like, work hard. There's no shortcut to success. You have to work hard.
And any guidance to our viewers who are still in school, like normal school, and are thinking of applying to architecture school?
I think architecture could be a real pain if you're not interested.
Yeah.
People think, you know, that's what I felt, oh, it's just drawing, there is no study, but it's literally a pain in the back, and figuratively it's a big pain too. So unless and until you are really passionate about designing, don't pursue it, it's a waste, because you will end up like burning yourself, you will end up torturing yourself, and there's no money also.
Yeah.
Also
the pay takes a lot from you.
Yeah.
And it's very bad.
I won't take the name, but I think 6 months back probably, I got an email from one of your colleagues who mailed me saying that I'm investing so much time, I'm investing so much money in this. I know I won't be getting anything out of it. Why am I doing this? Should I be doing something else?
Okay.
Yeah, so that was a very weird email I got. Then I had to call up and, you know, talk about it. But yeah, but so look at the bright side of it. You wake up every morning, even when, let's say when I go to my office, I know I'm going to get a project to design a residence, right? I know every single guy has the same plot size. Let's say everyone has a 40 by 60 plot. Everyone has a north facing plot. Everyone wants Vastu. Everyone wants 4 BHK. But they all want it different.
Yeah.
Imagine how creative.
Like the same set of.
So same parameter, right? Even your parametrics can't do that.
Yeah.
If you have the same parameters,
you will have the same output.
You will have the same result.
Yeah.
But here they are same. Everyone is the same. You ask 10 people, they have the same thing, same requirement, same budget, but they all want different. So that is where I think you enjoy it. And you know, if I think my biggest thing to the students or people who are doing this is, make it like your hobby, and you would never feel it, and you would actually enjoy architecture. It's an amazing feel. You can do whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
You just do whatever you want. It's as simple as that. All you need is to convince people that you have done it right.
Yeah, actually.
Even though back in the mind you know you haven't, but if you can speak it out, you can convince, it's good.
Yeah, that is what, because a lot of people who, when they, if not actually in the field, but I have experience for juries. So when they are giving juries, I mean, that is the advice when I give them. Like, first of all, make sure what you've done is good enough also. If it's total crap, people will see through it. But now you've done it, now is the point to start selling it.
Mm.
Now you have to make them convinced that this is the best thing possible ever.
No, I think, see, if you look at even the jury, best thing is, people say that they have been crit a lot. I feel the best juries are those where you have crit a lot.
Exactly.
Because that's where the jury is actually taking interest.
Yeah.
Like for me, if you ask me and I would probably speak like 2 minutes on a project, I have literally no interest in that. And so if I take interest, that's when I start killing you off.
Yeah, exactly. And also, you when somebody doesn't criticize your project, you don't need to learn anything from it. Just saying good, because I have juries like that.
Yeah,
but then what's the point? I mean, I did not get to learn anything from it. Like, thank you, but...
Yeah, but then it depends on the outlook, how you take it. Like, you may call it a bad jury, or it's actually a good jury.
Yeah, for a lot of people, it would be a good jury, but I just felt like maybe... It could be, could have been a better teaching moment for me as well.
It's good. That's how it should be. So I think, yeah, just work hard, be passionate, learn. Because one of the things I've also found while teaching in the school is most of the time students complain, oh, we don't have infrastructure, we don't have good faculty, no one taught out this. No one will.
Yeah, nobody is going to take as much interest in your education. You have to take it yourself.
If you take interest, they will.
Yeah.
If you don't take interest, like if you say, oh, my faculty didn't explain that, oh, go ahead. Like, you know, just keep bugging him.
Yeah.
He would have no choice but to help you out.
Yeah. That is what I kind of try to do in school as well.
Do that. Yeah, that's a good thing.
So that was the last question for today.
Great, we have done.
So that was it for Archiviews episode 3. I hope you guys like it. And please do like this video, please share this video, please subscribe to this channel. I'll leave the links for DesignQube Jaipur and certain other links for Sir down below.
Sure.
So you can go check them out. And that is it. I hope you like it. Keep waiting for episode 4.
Alright.
Bye bye.
Thanks a lot.